something in me felt, I'm not going to be good as a lawyer. I'm not going to be good as a doctor. I don't have that talent. I don't have that brain. I can't do it. When I was in college, I started to read these letters of Van Gogh to his brother, Theo. And they were unlike anything I'd ever read. They were like a whisper. They were like someone saying, you can do something that's different. And it was only as an adult, I was teaching and I wanted to create, I wanted to write. So I left teaching and wrote novels during the day, but at night I would be telling stories to my kids. And I'd tell them in the car, and I'd tell them as we raked leaves, and I'd tell them on the way to the dump. And I'd tell them when they were crying, oh, let me tell you a story, and they'd get lost, and the tears would dry up. The creaks in this barn mean so much to me. I was in this barn one day, and I had to tell a story at a library. I didn't know the story, and there was some sunlight on the right behind me, and it looked as if somebody had scratched something, and I could see it because of the sunlight. And suddenly I could see a character and made the story up. My friends would say, you've got to try to do this, Jay, in the big world. Go out to schools, go out to theaters. And that's when I finally discovered and acknowledged that I had a talent, and this was the way I wanted to use words. I've been telling stories maybe 23 years, closing on a quarter century. It all began in Marshfield, right here in Marshfield. I called a principal one day, and I'd told a lot of stories there. Mr. Dower, I'm a professional storyteller now. He said, wow, what's the difference? I said, you pay me. He said, oh.
I got a present for you. I'm worried about your coordination. He had a paper bag. What's the present? I'll show you. He reached in and pulled out a wooden paddle, and the paddle had an elastic going from the paddle way down to the ball. What you do is you pull it like that, ball. I said, you can do it. She said, thank you. She got the paddle and she pulled the elastic between her thumb and her finger. When she got to the ball, she pulled the elastic out of the ball. She said, you have the coordination, I'll have the ball.
As a storyteller, he has a lot of skills, but I think the most important thing is his ability to take an image and make it into something that lives for somebody else.
The way I tell, all I need is voice and body. And if a prop would help, I'd use it. But usually they get in the way for me because I shift character so quickly. Edna Robinson came marching into town, her elbows bruised there. Morning, Dr. Orr. Nice to see you, Dr. Orr. That's a nice carriage you have. Edna Robinson. Nothing stopped Edna Robinson. I want to go between the narrator and Edna Robinson herself and Dr. Royal. Got into town, she was standing with her back to the general store, a Curly Reed and Bryant, and there it's almost a mixture of the narrator and Edna Robinson. So that this fluidity is almost like a jazz trumpet. Doesn't need props, it just needs simplicity. And I realize the kids like rhythms, and you play with rhythms with sound. So sound, and what's going on? They're kind of interested. What's happening? And it's almost like a curtain party. Then the light is coming up, and then they see, putty, putty combs, bones, where is my bone? Then I say, I grew up in a wonderful neighborhood called Pill Hill. And suddenly I'm talking like an ordinary person. But I've interested them by surprising them, by doing something unusual, just using sound. And then I begin to talk, and then I go into the formal story.
The right hand, the left hand. Oh.
One of the differences between print, between a book, even a picture book, and storytelling is the body. There's a story of mine, tulips, tulips, and it's a book. But when I do it, it's tulips. So right away, I use my voice. And the beginning begins with, Madame Lefarge was a magnificent old woman. So there's the sense of her body. She was famous for her tulips, her red tulips. And Madame Lefarge, you sense that she's kind of grand just through the voice. I don't say she's grand, and I don't use a picture. I just use my voice. And I do that so that the imagination of the listener can suddenly make that illustration by themselves. And then when Pierre, she invited her grandson, Pierre. And then when I tell the story, I say, little Pierre, he bounced all the way to Paris. He was 5 years old. So I use the sense of the bounce to give a sense of his fun and his playfulness. So sound is a big difference in the use of body. So in the picture book, the illustrator has to do that. And rhythm is different.
Petruchian, the blacksmith. Petruchian was a blacksmith, and he was a huge man, and his shop was crowded. This was long ago. People were behind him watching his muscles and his sweat, and they were waiting for him to hit some burning metal. And they loved the rhythm of his work. Everybody blacksmith knows it today, every blacksmith, but it began with Petruchian. This is the rhythm. He would hit that burning metal. He would heat the metal and beat the metal.
In the story of Herman and Marguerite, the rhythm is, I'm Herman the Worman, and I like my squirming, and I like being close to the ground. And the illustrator has to do all of that with color. So there's quite a difference between books and picture books and storytelling, which is just the suggestions. It's marvelous how subtle the human imagination is. Give the right stroke, or the right sound, or the right silence, and the imagination gets to work. And that's perhaps the most interesting part of the work. Even if your story's been told 100 times, those people at that moment might change the littlest thing. So you're working together.
A knight, a skunk, didn't come. In its sharp claws, and its first, the skunk tried the apple. Sour. And then the skunk smelled the eggs, and the eggs were in trouble. And the skunk ripped at the earth, and was about to rip the case open with snap. The skunk heard the snap and frightened ran into the woods. The snap had been made by Mother Earth. She didn't want Michael and the others to die.
So when I tell a story, I want people to meet a character, to meet a person, and I want the audience to feel what's inside that character. I want to tell a very short story about a boy named Brian. I was leaving Seattle one day and someone said, I've got to tell you about Brian. He's a kindergartner. He's always in trouble because he's a dreamer. And his teacher is kind of stiff. Brian got to school one day. He was an hour late and his teacher said, I've had it. She left the room, marched down to the office, picked up the phone, called Brian's mother and said, he was an hour late, slammed the phone down. So all day, Brian's mother is wondering, what is wrong? Finally, Brian got home. She said, Brian, you were late. I know, he said. I was an hour late. Teacher was mad. I know she called me. You left early for school. What happened? Brian said, well, it must have rained because there were worms all over the sidewalk. I knew the kids would step on them, so I had to put them in the holes. It took a whole hour. She said, I love you, Brian. That's the story of Brian.